presentation is a little bit different from the ones that I had, the ones that you have on your agenda, you know? Actually, I thought this seminar would be something like an academic conference, so I thought of reporting my upcoming study. So now actually I switch a little bit to sharing my ideas, sharing the practice that I actually applied in some of my reading classes. So it will be using English articles as a transitional activity towards extensive reading.
When I'm a lecturer and I have more control in my classroom.
So I decided to organize an activity called Reading Station. In Reading Station, basically students, each student, would collect from 1 to 2 articles they have read online. Any topic, yes? And find them easy to understand and take them to class. Easy for themselves, from 1 to 2 articles, print them out, bring them to class. I would come to class and collect all of the readings that the students would bring to class. So I would divide all of the readings that I collected into 3 or 4 reading stations. I'll ask students to stand up, move around, pretend that you're a journalist, pretend that you're attending a reading fair where you can just sit everywhere you want, maybe on the teaching stage, maybe on the entrance door. Wherever you want, you find it easy and comfortable to read. It's for pleasure. And I ask the students to read for fun. So students would go around and pick the articles that they find the most interesting, that strikes them the most, especially from the titles. From the titles of the articles. So I personally have found super, super interesting articles that the students have collected and selected themselves. The students have selected some articles like this. Why Donald Trump has become the president of the United States. And then they're so eager to read about it. Another one, banana is going to become extinct. Then students were like, wait, what? Banana? I can't see that. And I'm going to read it. I'm going to read it. They read it with excitement and eagerness. You may ask me, then how do I measure the participation? And how would I evaluate their reading process? Because it seems like they read for nothing. Well, actually, I also have reading reflection. Reflection, when it finishes the whole class, well, let's talk about interesting topic. What do you like about today's reading stations? My students say, I love an article about an earthly fish competition in, in South America, somewhere. So they say that I find it so interesting. There's also a picture of it on the article. They print it out, and there's an image of a blobfish. And blobfish actually won the prize to become the earthliest fish on the planet. So the students find it interesting. I mean, I've never seen this fish, but I love to read about it. Then students would write reflection as proof of participation. The reading reflection, very small, but you don't have to read, I'm going to talk about it. The reading reflection has the following components. So first, students have to talk about the number of articles they have read during that day. So they start by something like, today I have read blah, 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 number of articles. And then summarize the articles that they have read during that day and pick the one that impressed them the most. Then they're going to reflect on their process, the progress as well. So they talk about how they feel about that reading station and how they like and dislike, and then their strengths and weaknesses as well. So I have got here proof of my students' reflection. They have written a lot. And to be honest, if they don't improve in reading, they're gonna improve in writing. So please pick one. Anything up here would be for you to get a brief overview of what my students have thought of this activity. I also asked my students to write date on the reading reflection, or number the reflections. So from reading station number one to reading station, let's say, number five, I've seen students who reported their progress. Good at inside. I'll be here a few minutes to transfer. If you pick up an article and just by false alarm at the beginning to reading the article and you think, oh, it's interesting, I'm going to read it. And then if you start to read half of the articles or a third of it, and you find, oh, this is so boring, I made a mistake, they're going to stand up. Go and change another one. Go find the ones that they find interesting and suitable for their levels. It's also an encouraging practice. So yes, a large class is an advantage. I previously thought that a large class may pose disadvantage to teachers, but now I wanted this one, this activity, to make use of it. Yes, and this is a common complaint from a lot of teachers. We complain that, all schools don't have enough graded readers. We don't have money to buy books. We don't have money to build libraries and fancy resources. Then actually, we don't wait until then. Please don't wait until you have enough money, you have enough funds to build a huge and modern library to do extensive reading. Just start from the beginning. Start from small. So this activity is actually one of the smallest steps that I think students can start to change their awareness. They used to read for questions, scanning. Now they read for fun, they read for information, they read for pleasure. Also, I will take some rationale from academia. So I take these top 10 principles for teaching extensive reading from Jay and Bamford. The 10 principles perfectly match what I have practiced in my classroom. So the first one, the reading material is easy. Yes, of course, students have got to choose the level they want, right? They're not forced to read something too difficult, just like an intensive reading. Then, a variety of reading material on a wide range of topics must be available. Yes, quite a lot of topics. Actually, 50 students can yield 50 topics. You never know. Politics, economics, social, you name it. Learners choose what they want to read. Yes, they get around. They get up, go around, pick their favorite one. Learners read as much as possible. Yes. You see, very changeable pace. Some students in the reading reflection, they report that they actually read up to 7 articles that day. And some others, they read 2. So, it's understandable. The purpose of reading is usually related to pleasure, information, and general understanding. Yeah, quite obvious. Now, number 6, reading is its own reward. I said before that my activity has created an atmosphere, a very friendly and open atmosphere for students. They can even sit on my table. Yes, some did. They go on the board and they find, this is hard, I need to draw some diagrams. So they took my marker and they draw some images on the board. For them to follow the reading easier, to retain something. So it's pretty much their interest. And reading speech is usually faster rather than slower. Yes, I've seen in reflection that students have reported that they feel that they read faster. I think this is important in building their confidence. Also, reading is individual and silent. Yes, that's right. Students pick one and find their own private, comfortable place to read. Teachers orient and guide the students. Yes, at the beginning of every course, every reading course, I talked about reading station. I talked about the websites, some of the websites that students may start from. And expand their search later on. I also, number 10, a role model, I also participated with my students in order to be able to discuss the articles available that day. So I personally read with the students, and the students see me reading, they often follow me and see which articles I'm reading, and if they see it's interesting, they're gonna, Miss Green, can I just get yours? Yeah. So they're quite interested in reading I think we have to talk about the results. Students report in their reflection that they have enjoyed reading more. They have read faster. That they encounter interesting vocabulary and language phrases. They felt that they wanted to reuse these vocabulary and phrases in their productive skills, oral speaking and writing. And they felt that if I want to have more interesting views, I need to learn more. So this is something of the change in awareness. So these are some of the websites that I recommended to my students to start from. To start from. Not limited to these, but to start from. These websites are pretty much like graded readers. They actually classify the news in levels. Level zero, the news, same news, but are written in, but it's written in easy language, simple language. So for example, Prince Williams and Kate Middleton do something, something, then this level zero will report the same news, but very simple language for level zero students. And so you can find from level zero to level six, or five or six. So very a wide range of levels available. And of course, you probably will find more online. As I said, huge resources on the internet. So here are some other news online. Of course, these are more advanced, and some are really, really hard. But I've seen that sometimes students read for key information. Students, even if they don't understand the whole thing, they still can get the main information, the main story, reported in these news. For example, Huffington Post, or Huffington Post, or later on, is maybe the Daily Mail. Those are quite daily stories, reporting kind of things. Students interested in those, and they frequently come to those sites to search for interesting things. Like I still remember a title of an article the student collected: "Riding bicycle is powerful for the environment." So it's like a switch from our normal, our common awareness of riding a bicycle. So they say that, oh, when we ride a bike, we exhale more CO2 and sweat and the chemicals that we have to wash the clothes and something like that. So pretty much interesting for the students to, you know, to have more perspectives. Yes, so thank you for your attention, and I would really like to have feedback, comments, and any questions relating to this activity. So thank you for your listening. So any questions so far? I probably have finished half an hour earlier than the amount of time. Thank you.
You said you initially were to present about your research.
Ah, yes.
So can you just give like a little short discussion of your research?
Uh-huh. So what you have on your hands now is part of my data sources. I'm going to analyze these portfolio, these reflections, to see the attitudes and motivations that arise from hearing the activity. So I personally am here to present the ideas, and I believe that this is helpful. Mm-hmm. But a research might, you know, have a little twist on it, like could present some more limitations to it. And I don't know yet. So I really want to ask the students, and I compose it with focus interview. I combine this and focus interview. So I hope to yield more data on what students think about this.
Yes. How many students are in your class, you know, classes? What's the student population?
I had 2-3 reading classes mm-hmm. that range from 40 to 45 mm-hmm. students.
And are they all, I guess their majors or their field of study is this like a general English class? Or are there specifically for English?
English department only teaches English majors.
Okay.
So we have students of English majors and mm-hmm. English pedagogy majors.
Okay.
So
these are concentrated, they want to use English.
Yes, they're quite advanced in English, but still we have a big gap mm-hmm. between students who are very low and students who are really, really advanced.
You know, I see a really good resource opportunity for you since you've got the students generate the articles. They find, and you've already got the list of the websites. So if you can, I think it would be helpful for a lot of teachers in Vietnam is like if you made a blog or a resource website, because you already know what the students like from just from your data collection.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, compile it, and then this way you can share it to other teachers. It's like,
yeah.
I know these are high interest, and I know that's what, and these are, and maybe even the student, I don't know, figure out a way for the students themselves to, you know, save their articles that they actually use and just compile it that way, but something like that
that's a very good point here. I plan to, I only thought half of your mm-hmm. Comments that I collected the readings, mm-hmm. the articles of my students. In one class, have already collected, and then I brought it to another class.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So it's like a pile like this, and I brought it to another class,
mm-hmm.
and this, they also increased like double of the number mm-hmm, of articles. So I've just thought of doing that manually.
Yeah, do it digitally.
Find
the computer department, and I think a lot of teachers that might be hesitant for this because. You know, they would be like, well, I don't know. You know, I have to go find the work. And then you could say, nope, here, go to this website. I've got 100 sources that have been proven by my students, generated by them. Go ahead and use them, and then your students can add to it too.
Yeah.
So, yeah, take the analog and let's make it digital this year. I'll help you.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
So I think it's great.
Which is why it's the articles. I just have a small concern if, you know, those kind of publishing the articles,
I mean, just links. I'm imagining is like the students basically, it would be like a Reddit or something. It's very, very simple, but you know, you just have a go-to site, and then somehow you have to go through and kind of categorize mm-hmm. the levels
yes.
for the teachers, but that way, and also the topics,
yes.
but it's just links to the direct articles.
Mm-hmm.
And so you don't have to worry about copyright because it's just
mm-hmm.
links,
okay.
but
yeah.
it's all there.
Credits.
Mm-hmm.
That's a good point. Thanks.
So you're just doing qualitative with your research?
Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Have you thought about asking to see if doing timed reading to see if the students' reading speed increases?
Oh, yeah.
I think that's a really important thing. One of the important things about a sense of reading is that reading speed increases. So when in extensive reading, they often use that to judge when to move to the next level. When the reading speed gets to be over 130, they suggest the student should go to the next level of text. You may also want to do some vocabulary tests to see if their vocabulary, and there's 4 or 5 online that we can run the students through repetitively and see if they improve. And then you can plug that into your interview
mm-hmm.
and draw some conclusions from there.
Yeah. My only concern is I'm not sure if the hesitate to use the vocabulary test since they're quite limited in the way they test the students. But, you know, it's hard to measure competence, to be honest.
Mm-hmm.
I don't really have high hope for it.
Well,
yeah.
Honestly, I'm the same thing as you.
Yeah.
And I use Paul Nation's website.
Uh-huh.
He has speed reading materials.
Yeah.
You just copy out the materials. It takes about 10-15 minutes in the class. And students just do that every month or so, and then they see a record of how their speed is increasing or decreasing. Mm-hmm. And that's a really easy, simple way of doing it. I mean, there may be more ways that give you more deep data, but this is a very simple way of doing it. I think maybe there are vocabulary tests on there too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Very, very easy.
How do you measure the speed?
Oh,
I just can't get.
Well, you just have a timer.
Oh.
You have a set of texts which all are already selected at the same level, mm-hmm. and then you have a timer, and put the timer on. Maybe use the one online.
So no questions follow.
You can there are questions to follow, okay. And you can include those in the time. You can have the time to read before you look at the questions, and then you can have the time to complete the questions with, say, 60% accuracy. Mm-hmm. And that tells you whether they're, how much they're actually reading, mm-hmm. and how much they're pretty
good. Yeah, yeah.
Really, very, very easy.
Okay.
And very complete instructions on that.
Yeah.
Just go to Formation.
Paul, how do you spell it?
Formation.
Formation. Yes.
When you have the students generated, they collect the articles, is that something that is homework on their own time? Is that class time? Do they have to spend their own money to print it out? I'm just wondering, like, what are the logistical, what are the challenges for them that the student's like, I don't have my article? I mean, when you just have to search and pick and print it out, but are there challenges to that three-part process?
Yes, I see what you mean. Actually, printing costs here in Vietnam is quite cheap.
Mm-hmm.
that's to mention. Maybe $1,000, $2,000,
mm-hmm.
for two articles. Those are quite affordable,
mm-hmm.
I think. I've known classes, like, students have to give money to make a fund for the whole class to make photocopies of reading texts.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean...
Why can't they do that? I mean, you could do that for printing costs, too. Or I don't know. I'm just
Wondering, you mean collecting money from students at the same time?
Yeah, I mean, if I don't know if some students have issues financially that are like, well, I can't, even though it's cheap, they, whether it's true or not, you know, that's their excuse. It's like, I can't afford the printing cost, but, so I want to figure out the workarounds, like, no, everyone, how do we get everyone to bring in an article, two articles, five articles, whatever, a week, or is it maybe a class activity too, or it's only homework,
okay,
you know?
There's something interesting when I first started 2 years ago, and then I keep updating it. Until now, I have students read articles, and I say, hey, if you like the articles, hit a like on it. Hit a heart on it. Hit like an emoticon on it. So the students were eager, and then I say, if you are miss of the class, or you got the top position for that day, you're going to get a present, or a bonus mark. So students were quite excited, were more excited to bring more articles and select a bit more carefully. Yes, previously I had the same problem when students were like, just go online, type something, print it out, bring it to class. Where we saw like articles that are very chaotically chosen. So
maybe you need a rubric or a criteria, some guidelines for them, so you have more qualitative stuff.
I got some guidelines, just brief guidelines. I don't want to restrict the students too much. Just some guidelines that it must be something you have read, so you yourself have to read that article. Even if sometimes I dare to show other students that I'm going to check on you. If you haven't read it, you can go home, for example. So the students bring them out and bring to class, and time by time I feel that maybe sometimes the quality of the articles may decrease over time. So the students were eager at the beginning, but towards the end of the course or something, the students were like, oh, nobody's going to care about it. Let's just go online and find stuff. But I got an incentive. The students, when they read an article, they feel they love it, they're going to write a heart up here, or they hit a like, or if it's too difficult, they're going to draw an emoticon angry. So, angry emoticon on top, or like a crying face on top of it, to indicate that actually they find it so either boring or too difficult, or things like that. So when I flip through, I can tell quickly that this is a popular one. So we still have, we only have 20 minutes left till the closing ceremony. And I'll see you at the closing ceremony, by the way. Yes, okay. Yeah, so we should call it a day for today, I guess. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.